Okay, we're all going to go through that door there for part number one. Okay, I'm going to lead the way, so I'm going to go through the door now myself. Follow me. Let's go through this door here. Okay, very good. Almost everybody is here. Some people got stuck back at the hallway, so I was trying to help them. And this is our part floor. It's kind of like a part of the book, and it has a whole floor. If you want to leave here, you can go up the escalator over there. Either escalator has an exit sign. Just walk into the exit sign and you go out, and then go through the door to come back. Okay, so I think everybody's doing pretty good. This is our part number one. Part number one has different sections. So the first section is vocabulary. So let's everybody follow me through the vocabulary door. So come on with me through vocabulary. Okay, everybody, come on in here. Vocabulary. Walk slowly. Take your time. Okay, everyone. Okay. Thank you. Very good. Good job. Let's all go through the vocabulary door. Okay, come on. Alright, I'm going to go into. Now we just be patient, wait a minute, everything downloads. Here we go, very nice. Okay, so this is our vocabulary room. Okay, pretty cool, right? So, you should have practiced your vocabulary already when you did your videos. So, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on vocabulary, but I do want to quickly go over to show you the keywords and maybe some special ideas. So I want you to follow me, and I'm going to fly up and go up to the screen so we can see it more clearly. So how do you fly? Remember, page up. Right, page up. Here we go. There we are. Wonderful. So we're right up to the screen so we can see the vocabulary very clearly now, right? Very good. Also, please remember, you can turn your head up or down or left or right by using the control button on your keyboard. Hold down control and you can turn your head up and down to see things a little bit better. Get the angle a little bit better. Control and then move your mouse up and down. Okay, let's go over some of the vocabulary here just very quickly. And let me just jump through them, and I'll stop at ones that are kind of key. So, agreement. Agreement, of course, is our goal. We want to reach an agreement. Now, the next word, argument, is often misunderstood. A negotiation is not an argument, although people often sound like they're arguing. But it's not an argument. Now, the next word, at least, is very important, and we're going to use this idea a lot in the future, especially about two or three chapters later. This at least, and the next line, the next word, bottom line, the next phrase, these are very related. We often use these in negotiation to be talking about what's the lowest I can accept, what's my bottom line, or what's the thing I need at least. And so these are two really useful ones I hope you can keep in mind and use a lot when you negotiate. Now, compromise is something we always talk about, and we're going to learn more about it in future chapters. But compromise doesn't mean that you give up. It just means that you give something to get something. Count on is a very simple phrase. In a negotiation, it's really making a kind of a promise. Can you count on something? Disagreement is, of course, something that is important for negotiation. We're going to learn about that in a minute, because every negotiation must have some kind of disagreement. Flexible. Now, flexible, of course, means you're willing to change. And we can always say we're willing to change, but we're going to learn later it's always not so simple or straightforward. Goal. Now, goal is really key. You need to know what your goal is. And I find that most people, when they negotiate, the number one mistake they make is they don't have their goal clear. We're going to talk about that in a few minutes. In the middle, meaning that there's a little bit higher, a little bit lower, so you choose in the middle. It's kind of like compromise. Inflexible is something that we don't want other people to be, because they won't give us anything to get something, but sometimes you actually win your negotiation by being inflexible. So anyway, let's go on here. Issue. Issue is the topic you're going to be talking about. And then the last few words over here. Make everyone happy, of course, is what we always say we want to do, but it's not always what we really want to do to make everyone happy. And of course, very basic negotiation, and then finding a solution. Strategy. We're going to talk much more about strategy a couple chapters later. And then to be honest. Now, to be honest is something we often say in negotiation. It's kind of like the word inflexible or flexible. These are words we say, but we don't really mean them. In other words, everyone always says, I'm being honest, but it doesn't mean they're being honest. And everyone always says, I'm being flexible, but it doesn't mean they're being flexible. All right, so I just want to check, because one student's texting me saying she can't hear me. So the people here that are close to me, like Roy and Emma, can you hear me now? Is my lecture clear? Okay, good, good, good. Wonderful. Okay, sometimes remember, if you get far away, you can't hear anymore. And also, sometimes we need to maybe log out or log in, or we need to use the menu tools and audio and reconnect the audio. Okay, so that's the vocabulary. You did a homework on it, so you're probably very familiar with it. So what we're going to do now is we're going to take a short break. I know everybody's done a good job so far. You guys are doing great. You've logged in. You've gotten your avatars working. Your avatars all look good. Roy's avatar with that red hair, that's pretty unusual, pretty different. Spiky red hair. And everyone's doing a good job. You control your avatars very well. So what we're going to do is we're going to take a break. So we just sit down our avatar here for a few minutes. And then in about 10 minutes, we're going to come back. So if you want to eat your breakfast real fast, or get something to eat, or go to the washroom, do that. So we're going to take a break for 10 minutes. Then we're going to come back and cover the rest of the chapter. Okay, so break time. Good job, everybody. Okay, so what we're talking about today is a basic introduction. So let me begin with the most fundamental idea, which is negotiation is about satisfying needs. Now, maybe if you studied economics before, you understand things like needs, wants, those kinds of things, and how you use your money to buy things and satisfy your needs. Well, it's kind of the same idea as that. Only now what we're talking about is the needs of maybe you or your family, or maybe your boss, maybe your business, maybe your company. It could be many different kinds of needs, not always your personal needs, although personal needs is a kind of need also. One thing we need to keep in mind is that Negotiation is not really always natural for everyone. Lots of times when you're young, your parents, your mother, your grandmother, your father, grandparents, they may teach you about negotiation, but for many of us, we don't really get a lot of exposure. Maybe you stay home and you study, your parents want you to be a good student, or they want you to be good at something, but they don't really take you shopping, they don't take you places where they negotiate. You don't see a lot of negotiation, I would say. So, in general, we can say that probably lots of people grow up and they don't practice negotiation a lot. So you're not comfortable with it. And sometimes people get confused and think, well, negotiation is not good, it's more like an argument, it's more like arguing. But what we need to learn in this class is negotiation is about satisfying needs. Those needs could be your personal, your company, your boss, your business, your personal business, it could be anything. But you need to get that clear. It's not about arguing, it's not about fighting, it's a way to get your needs. So, the first dialogue we have in this part is a person-to-person inside of a family. So it's between Fred and Jane. So follow me and we're going to go over the first dialogue. So everybody, let's go to room number 3. Follow me. Over here, everybody. Room number 3. Yep, there you go. Everybody come on into the next room. Very good. Excellent. Let's go. Okay, great. Everybody's in here. Very good. Slowly. Oh, yeah. Here comes everybody. I see everyone. Okay, what we have here is the first dialogue. Now, inside of our book, we have usually two kinds of dialogues. One is a kind of family personal dialogue. This lets you see that negotiation takes many forms, including inside your family. But we also usually have a business dialogue. Today we're going to keep things simple. We have this family dialogue. So in this dialogue between Fred and Jane, they're having a discussion. Now, I'm not going to read the dialogue because you've already read it and you had a quiz on it. But I would like to just quickly point out the main ideas of the dialogue between Fred and Jane. And that is that Fred and Jane both have something they want to do, don't they? What do Fred and Jane both want to do? Can somebody answer that question for me? Anybody, just speak up. Feel free to speak up. Fred and Jane are married, so they're husband and wife. What do both Fred and Jane want to do? They want to take a vacation, right? They want to take a vacation. Everybody needs a vacation, right? I'm sure all of you have had vacations with your families, yeah? So, a vacation is something they agree on. This is a key point to the beginning of this class. To have a negotiation, it's important to begin with something that you both want. Both sides, maybe sometimes more than two sides, maybe three sides or more, but something in common. And here, Fred and Jane both want something in common. What do they want? A vacation. They agree. So they do agree on something. So every negotiation begins with something you agree on. If you don't agree on anything, if Jane wants a vacation and Fred does not want a vacation, then they cannot negotiate about where to go. That's a different negotiation. They need to negotiate about whether or not to have a vacation, right? So in this case, what's the thing in common? They both want a vacation. What's the thing that's different? What's different between these two? The place. The place, right. The place to go. Very good. Now, Jane wants to go to Disneyland, right? California. And Fred, he would prefer to go to visit another country to see something international. So this is the thing that's different. So every negotiation needs something that's the same and something that's different. We begin with something in common and something not in common. And both sides want to maximize. So in this discussion, in this negotiation, what do we see? We see that both Fred and Jane, step by step, explain why they think their choice is the better choice. So Jane will say, the kids want to have fun, the kids want to go somewhere where their friends have gone, the kids want to do things that other kids do, and Fred is saying, well, I want to go somewhere and have the kids learn something. I want it to be a good experience. So both sides tell what is their values, what are they thinking of, and what is it that they need. Okay, so in the end, you can see that there's a little bit of a problem in the end of this negotiation. Why? Because it's really hard to compromise. And I use this example on purpose because I think it's a good example. Often when we think of negotiation, or when we read a book about negotiation, or we read a business book, we often think, maybe we can all compromise and have a win-win situation. Now, we're going to study win-win later, but today I just want to point out, sometimes, lots of times, maybe most of the time, win-win is not really possible. Look at this example here between Fred and Jane. One wants to go to Disneyland and one wants to go to another country. How can you satisfy both of these sides? How can you split it in the middle? Right? Sometimes when we negotiate at the night market or we want to buy a product, maybe your price is $10 and the seller's price is $5. So what can you say? You say, let's split it in the middle. Maybe give me $7.50 or go someplace in the middle. Maybe $6 or $7 or $7.50. That's splitting it down the middle. But how can you split a vacation down the middle? It's a little bit hard. It's very hard. Maybe not even possible. So I begin the book by saying, you know, number one, negotiation is not argument. Jane and Fred are not arguing, they're negotiating. Number two, Jane and Fred have something in common. They both want something that's the same, a vacation. And then number three, but they have something that's different. One wants to go to Disneyland and one wants to go to overseas to get some culture. And the next thing is, sometimes you cannot, most of the time, often you cannot satisfy by just splitting it down the middle. So things are very difficult. Okay, so that's the basic idea of the beginning of understanding negotiation. Let's move on to the next room. So follow me to the next room, everybody. Let's go to the next room. Room number 4. Come on, everybody, over here. Next room. Next room, this will be room 4. Okay. All right, everybody, let's go to room number 4. All right, we're waiting for everybody to catch up with us here in room number 4. Okay, so this is the vocab with example sentences. Now, I know vocab can be very boring and, you know, something that you feel, well, I got it tedious to study this again. But I really think it's important for you to go over these sentences and to use them in your, of course, in your homework, but also to try to remember some of them to use later when we have our negotiation. Let me explain why something that seems so boring is very important. The reason is that when we negotiate, we tend to not have a lot of time to think about things. You certainly can't check a dictionary, check a book. So you really need to have sentences ready to say quickly. You need to have sentences ready to use. They're kind of like your tools in your toolbox. And so by practicing these sentences, you're really getting ready for your negotiation that you can use them. And all of these are very, very common used in negotiation. For example, the very last one on our list is to be honest. And remember I told you, to be honest is a great one because it says, I'm trying to tell you I'm honest, even though you may not be. Nobody ever says in a negotiation, hello, I'm dishonest. Right? Nobody ever says that. They always say, honestly, to be honest. Well, to be honest, the price is already below cost. That's what they always say. Or, to be honest, we never expected demand to be so high, so we always thought that the price would be okay. So this is a great little resource, a tool in your toolkit. Please don't skip over it, because when we begin our RPG game, you're all going to be under time pressure. Not a lot of time, and you're all going to be under pressure to do good. So the more you can remember these sentences, the faster you'll be able to get through your negotiations or to find the groups that you don't want to buy from or you do want to buy from. Very key. Okay, so on the one hand, vocabulary, boring. On the other hand, super, super useful. And this is not just a language thing. Even me, I need to remember these sentences so I can use them when I negotiate. Otherwise, when you negotiate, you just say things that are not helpful or don't help you win. Okay, so that's all I want to do on this. I'm sure you've practiced it for your homework. So we're going to go to the next section, which is follow-up. So everybody, follow me to the next room. Come on to the next room. Follow-up. Okay, look up at the screen, and what I want to really show you is this graphic today. This is the thing I really need you to pay attention to, and that is a negotiation has these main stages. And they're very important to remember because when you negotiate, you need to really do different things at different stages. So what's the very first stage? The first stage is, what's your goal? What's your goal? Now this is really super important. The reason this is important is maybe you have some experience I can try to understand. Maybe you've been to the day market or the night market or some Fengjiao University market over there. You've been somewhere. Maybe you bought something and you negotiated. So let's say that you bought something. Maybe I bought sunglasses. Okay, so I went to the market to buy some sunglasses. So I go and I find some sunglasses I like. Now, of course, you know if you go to like Fengjiaye, the night market at Fengjiao, you know that they sell night glasses, and you know that maybe there's a price there. Maybe the price says 500 NT, $500. So that's the price that's on the label. But you know, we all know that if we go to the market, we can maybe say, hey, 500 seems high. Can you give it to me for 400? Then, of course, what will the salesperson say when you say 400? They'll say, oh, no, 500 is already the lowest. And then maybe you'll say, well, what about 450? And then what will they say? Oh, no, the glasses cost me more than 450. I'd lose money. And then you say, okay, 475. And then what does she say? She says, okay, 475. So the original price was 500. And then you buy the glasses for 475. Okay, great. You think you got a good deal, right? You save $25, which is not a small percentage. Very good for you. But then you come to school and you see one of your classmates. And what does your classmate tell you? He says, oh, I like your glasses. I have sunglasses just like that. You say, oh, really? Where did you get your sunglasses at? And he says, oh, I bought them at the Fengjiao Night Market. And you say, well, I bought my sunglasses at the Fengjiao Night Market also. How much did you pay? And he tells you, I paid 400. And you say, whoa, you paid 400. I paid 475. And I thought, I negotiated. I thought I bargained. I thought I got a good deal. actually, you got 400 and I got 475. So of course, what happens to your feeling? You feel very upset, you feel angry, you feel stupid. Like, how could I make such a mistake? And the woman told me that even 475 she thought was too low. Okay, now we run into a very basic question here. If I bought my sunglasses for 475 and another person bought their sunglasses for 400, what can we say about that? Who was right, or who was wrong, or who was more better off? Who got something better? Well, I think on the one hand, it's easy to say the person who paid 400 paid less, so that must be a better deal. Yeah, okay, that's easy to understand. But then another question is, when you paid 475, are you happy with that? How did that make you feel? If it's okay with you to pay 475, then maybe 475 isn't so bad. So in negotiation, the problem is, how do we know what things are good and what things are bad? Is 475 bad and 400 good? Or what about 300? Wouldn't that be better then? What about 100? Wouldn't that be better? Wouldn't zero be best? We should always buy everything zero. That's the answer. Everything should always be zero. Of course, that's impossible. So in negotiation, we have this very key problem. That is, how do you know if your negotiation was successful or not successful? How do you know if you did a good job or not? And how do you know, did you do a good job compared to someone else? How much better were you, or how much worse were you? Well, these are very hard questions to ask, because we just don't know. 475, is that good or bad? I don't know. 400, is that good or bad? I don't know. 400 seems better than 475, but is it? I don't really know. How much better? 2 times better? 3 times better? 10 times better? So when we begin negotiation, the first step is to set a goal. A goal means, what do you think the value of the sunglasses are to you? This question seems very easy. Of course, everybody always answers, lower is better, zero is best. But that's not possible. It's not possible the sunglasses could be zero. And it's not possible you can just keep going lower and lower and lower, because obviously there's a place where you have to decide to buy. So the question is, what's the value to you? Now, let me give you another example. Let's say that your mother tells you, go buy me sunglasses. So your mother gives you a job, go buy me sunglasses, okay? What's the first question you ask? You tell her, well, you know, what kind do you want, right? And then you say, what price do you want? Because you can't come home with sunglasses from Christian Dior or something like this and say, hey mom, here's your sunglasses, $10,000. Because I think your mom would kill you, right? So what do? You say, mom, what kind do you want, basically? And how much are you willing to spend? Don't we always say that? You know, what's your budget? Now, if your mom told you, my budget is no more than 500, and I would like to pay 475 would be okay. Now then, if you go to the market and you find the sunglasses for $500 and you bargain down to 475, you take the sunglasses home, give them to your mom, and what's your mom say? Wow, I like these. How much did they cost? And you say 475. And what's your mom say? Perfect. That's what I wanted. No more than 500, and the best would be 475. Thank you. So in that case, our goal was 475, and we got it for 475. So now what do we say? Success. Now, if you talk to your friend and he said he got it for 400, does that change anything? Does that make your mother unhappy? Well, probably you don't want to tell your mother. You don't want to go home and say, hey, mom, my classmate got it for 400. Look how stupid I am. You don't want to say that. But your mom's not going to be unhappy, is she, if she doesn't know about this price? She wanted to get it for 475. She got it for 475. You reach your goal. So in negotiation, we need to begin by remembering it's not always just get the lowest possible. That is not a way to succeed in negotiation because, just like this example, the glasses are not always your glasses. The money is not always your money. The situation is not always so simple or straightforward, right? Let's say you go to the market, you go to the night market and you find the glasses for 500 and you bargain and the woman says, okay, 475 is okay, I'll sell them to you for 475. And you say, no, I want to get lower. And you argue, you negotiate and you talk and talk and talk, but after 30 minutes you give up and you go home. And you say, mom, the glasses were 475, but I didn't buy them because I wanted to get lower. I think I'd get lower. And what's your mom say? She says, that's great, good. I'm glad you wanted to get lower, but I need the sunglasses tomorrow morning because I'm going out. I needed them now. Now you have no glasses. I gave you money. I was happy to spend $475 and you give me nothing. So now I have $475 and no glasses. Tomorrow when I go out, I don't have my sunglasses and I cannot use money on my eyes. What am I going to do? So you see, negotiation. When we really practice negotiation, it's very important to begin with our goal. Later, when our negotiation is done, we use the goal to judge, were we successful or not successful? If my goal is $475, but I end up paying, let's say, $480, then I go home and show my mom, and she says, I did not want to spend more than $500. I would like to spend $475, so you bought it for $480, you know, $5 off. This is not exactly what I wanted, but it's close. Now if you buy it for $490, that's less close. That's further away from my goal. If you buy it for $500, that's the worst thing you could do. But then if you buy it for $510, that's definitely bad because I told you don't go over $500. You see? So by having a clear goal, it makes us, number one, clear on the value. What is it you're trying to get? How much are you willing to spend? How much are you willing to try or put energy into negotiating for something else? So the first step is the goal. And I have to tell you that the hardest part most people forget is setting a goal. They just walk in and say, lower is better, right? Or pay the same price, but get more, right? Or higher quality, I don't care, just higher, higher is better. Well, the problem is you can't do that because then you don't have a clear goal. Then you can't judge, did you succeed or fail? Okay, so the first step is goals. I want you to take this serious, and in the future, you need to set your goals when we have our RPG game. Specifically, you need to work with your groups. So when we play our game, when we play our RPG, it's very important to begin beforehand to sit down with your group or online with your group and say, what's our goal? Is your goal to get the sunglasses for $500 or $475 or $480? What's your goal? Tell me what the goal is so I know what to shoot for, so I know how to judge, are we successful or not successful? Key point. After you have your goals, then you can begin to make some strategies. That is your overall plan, how to do it. And from your strategies, you're going to encounter some issues. What are the main problems? What are the main subject of this? What's the main topic? Is it about quality? Is it about quantity? Is it about shipping time? Is it about the product type? Or is it just about the money? Those are the issues. In Fred and Jane's case, Fred and Jane had some issues, right? Their issues were they wanted the kids to have some fun and to do what other kids do. But another issue was they wanted to have some education and learn something. So these are issues that surround the negotiation. And then finally, you need to make a plan. So what are we going to do in this negotiation? So all of these stages here, goals, strategies, issues, and planning, these are things you do when you're getting ready for your negotiation, not after you've begun, because then it's too late. The hardest part most people encounter in negotiation is they just walk in and they just say, I'm going to get more, or I'm going to pay less, no matter what. Pay less. Less is better, and get more product is better. But that's not the way to do it. That's not going to help you succeed in the long run, because a negotiation is not just one negotiation. You could have many negotiations when you go back to buy again, or when you have a relationship with a buyer or a seller. So, goals, strategies, issues, planning. Before negotiation begins, these are the things we need to think of. These are the steps we need to go through. Make a clear goal. Think of some strategies. Describe the issues, the key issues that are important to you, and then make a plan. Now later you may change your plan, but you need to have a plan. Especially important when you have a group of people negotiating, not just one person. Because when you have a group of people, you need to be on the same plan, right? If you have five people negotiating or three people in your group and you talk to other groups, you talk to other buyers, you talk to other sellers, if each person in your group has a different idea, has a different plan, then how can you work together? So we need to have a plan in common. That's the idea. Okay, so I think that kind of covers the main thing I want to raise today. The very big important idea of part number one is, before you begin a negotiation, you need to really think about it. You need to really talk with your group members, which in real life would be your company or your team, your negotiation team. Okay? So, is there any question about these four stages that you do before your negotiation? Goals, strategies, issues, and planning. Anybody have a question? Just feel free. Press your talk button and ask me a question if you have a question. This is the exercise section, and the exercises will be covered in our quizzes, so please remember to always do the exercises, because they will sometimes be in the quizzes, or some part of the exercise will be in the quiz. Okay, everybody, come on over towards me here, gather around. Okay, everybody here. If it's hard for you to hear me, come a little bit closer. Remember, come closer makes it easier to hear. Further away, harder to hear. All right. Okay, this is our puzzle. Every chapter has a little vocabulary puzzle. And again, this is kind of your homework, although I have no way to check it. I trust that you do it. It's a great way to practice your vocabulary and to remember some of those key words and phrases. So please remember to give that a try, maybe when you're on the bus or when you're sitting at home or you're in another class and it's kind of boring. Just take that out and try to do that puzzle. Vocabulary puzzles, these are called crossword puzzles, are a great way to exercise your brain in remembering key phrases and words. Really, really a good way. So please don't skip over it and think, oh, this is silly, it's too easy. I know it's easy, that's the point. I don't want to make things hard for you. I'm trying to show you easy ways to get these sentences of vocabulary that will help you negotiate. So So please do remember to do those exercises, practice, and the puzzle is great fun. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to wrap up the class. In this next week, you're going to have to look at part two of the book. Part two. And same thing. Do everything in the part you can. Practice the vocabulary. Practice with the exercises. Do the puzzle. Look over the word bank and maybe practice some writing. And then we're going to have a quiz next week again. Next week I'm going to lecture just like this, part two. And you also, for homework, have to make a video from the vocabulary again. So now we begin. Every week you have all these things to do. Read the chapter, watch my lecture video, prepare for a quiz, an online quiz, and your homework is to make a video using the vocabulary. Right? Goodbye, everybody. Have a good day. Have a good week.